Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. Let's put the fuel in here so we can get the console running so we can get the door open. Pour fuel into the tank. The lieutenant assists you, holding the canister up to the fuel tank as you tilt. Dark brown viscous fluid pours out and the room fills with a chemical smell. There's a red starter switch on the side of the cylinder and a start rope on the other side. The lieutenant flicks the switch and I pull the rope. The recoil start wakes the old generator up. The machine sputters like an old warhorse before settling down to a rattle. That should do it, Kim says. Okay, now that's just left us to open the blast door. And for that, we have to go down here. And then over here. A dim golden glow animates the console, faint like a ghost light. Urgence, overt, reads one dial key. Alamur reads another. It's on, he smiles. Turn emergency open. Could this open the blast door? I think yes. Let's see. He points to the emergency dial switch. That one. The emergency open. What if I push light interior? The lighting in the room turns on with a sizzle, a dim ambient orange. How about sliding the radio dial? The dial slides under the dusty glass, dark and silent despite the power being on. You make out the defunct stations on the UKV frequency. The words Feld Insular are written on the band. This is an off-air radio computer, I believe, used for radio military communications. I think you said that before. Encyclopedia says it's an air-gap system, an off-air military model. Its circuits are nearly impossible to bend, i.e. it cannot be remote-controlled. Okay, turn emergency open. The blast door opens with a series of clicks. A shaft of light appears, then widens as the light shines in. Dust settling, I love it. After you, the lieutenant gestures at the opening. What if we get into another fight? Don't worry, he takes out his sidearm, checks the barrel, then holsters it again. I have a gun. I also have a gun. I know, it was not easy to acquire. Yeah, tell me about it. What's there? I don't know. Let's go. Maybe I should have my gun ready. That's an antique rifle. Here we go. That'd be a good idea. I actually should have had that out already. I thought the footsteps I was hearing were other than the two of ours. This goes out, I guess. And then what's anything? Oh, I can't even step there. All right. A rubber dinghy. It's deflated, broken. Is that what the other person used to get out here? Small white flowers blossom all around you. There's the mattress that the sniper used. There's someone standing there, or sitting there rather. We get a good look at this person. Nowhere else to go. So I wish we had gotten a better look at Dolores Day, but at least we can get a good look at this. This must be the fire guy. A.K.A. possibly the sniper. Unless Harry was the sniper. The deserter. It panned out anyway. An old man wearing tracksuit trousers leans on the frame stock of his rifle. He gathers a big ball of spit in his mouth. Then spits it out into the extinguished fire before him. He raises his black eyes, hooded by creased eyelids, to meet yours. Perception says, unclouded by cataracts, his eyesight is sharp. Well, it would have to be if he's the killer. Empathy says, he's practically tearing up from spite. Hatred got the best of him a long time ago. This man hates everything. Are you the fire guy?
The what now? I can't hear you.
He cups his ear. Alright, so good sight, but bad hearing. Did you recently tell two kids to put out their fire? Two twins?
I may have. All sorts of little rats have come sniffing around, trying to give up the position.
Savoir Faire says, the position? Sounds like a hiding place. The mattress and the lookout to the whirling in rags.
Fire guy. Regressive bourgeoisie henchman. Can't even talk like a grown-up.
He shakes his head. Nice gun you've got there.
It's not nice. It's a piece of shit. Gets the job done.
What make of rifle is that, exactly?
It's a Trigon 4.46.
That matches the bullet. 4.46 millimeters or something like that? Encyclopedia says, Southeast Samarin made, exotic, must be defunct, too. No modern rifle manufacturer of that name springs to mind. Trigon 4.46. Locate a working firearm that shoots 4.46 ammo. Ta-da.
A Samarin rifle? How did you get hold of one?
It was sent to us by our brothers in the Xinyao commune. Military aid.
He pats the rifle. Head-eye coordination says it has stayed true to him. He can still make it sing. The Xinyao commune?
You heard me. It's good now. Like chalk wiped from a board.
His gaze turns inward. Did you close the blast door?
I did. And you opened it. How?
I fueled the generator, then used the console.
I should have burned that console down.
He shakes his head. How did you know I was coming?
The boat engine on the water.
He gestures north. Yeah, I guess you can't sneak up very easily then. You've retained your eyesight.
My eyesight, yes. Helps me see all this shit.
Your weapon has stayed true to you. Mine has stayed true to me, too.
Yes, I bet you killed a lot of people with it, you fascist fuck.
His eyes narrow.
Have you come to make me one of them?
His grip on the rifle tightens.
We have come to ask you questions, nothing more.
The lieutenant puts his hand on his holster.
If you do not comply, we will take you in. Do you understand?
Another spitball lands in the ashes. That's all the answer he gives. Sir, I need you to put down that gun so we can talk further. We're with the police. The lieutenant pulls his pistol from the holster.
You're a glorified night watchman. This is a service rifle. I can only lay it down before an enemy commander of corresponding rank.
Kim? The lieutenant aims his pistol square at the man's forehead.
Put it down now, sir.
Or you're going to blow my brains out before you question me. To hell with it. It's a walking stick anyway. It's out of bullets.
The old man lays the rifle down carelessly, then looks at it lying there. Yeah, we had 42% of chance of that. I don't know. If I had failed in that, he would have shot one of us, so... Good thing Kim succeeded at his check. Pain threshold says, like an amputated limb in the sand. Conceptualization says, he stares on, his wrinkled mouth moving without a sound. A strange sadness, like a song. What did you say?
The future teaches you to be alone.
Conceptualization says, the present... Let him say it.
The present, be afraid and cold.
The old man pulls back the hood of his plastic cape and looks up into the sky. It's blue-gray, the same color as the sea. Those words, the future teaches you. Real music. It's La Revacholiere, you bougie dog. Chants under Solat of the Black and Whites. Authority says, you need to address that remark. I'm not a boot-licking bougie dog. I'm a half-dead police officer who's just doing his job. The job of a bougie dog. What is La Revacholiere? It is the anthem of the World Revolution. His eyes remain fixed on the sky. One of three. In Grad, they sang Brave Children, Favorites of History, and Sin Yao, it was. He struggles to remember, then gives up. Some Samaran crap, I guess. How's it go, the song? How did it go? He looks at his gun on the ground and shakes his head slowly. Something about shooting rabbits. I don't know. I can't remember. It doesn't matter. It's gone now. Composure says he waves erratically with his hand, annoyed that he can't remember. A little tremor passes through him. Empathy says it was dear to him. He resents regretting it. And who are you? My name, looks across the water, then back at you, is Iosef Ilyanovich Dross, political commissar of the 114th Anti-Aircraft Division of the 4th Army of the Commune of Revachol. I am a deserter, a partisan, and a prisoner of war. This is my termless surrender. His eyes turn to the reeds again, dead and dull. The Commune of Revachol, the lieutenant forgets to close his mouth. Do you mean the ICM? You're a holdover from the Insulindian Citizens Militia, the Army of the Revolution. I was recruited in Jamrock in 07, trained in the Ecole de Contrôle Aérien, and consigned to emergency defense duties in 08. I left my unit on the eve of the landing. When I returned here on May 14th, the Commune had fallen. Still armed and ideologically trained, I wrote a criticism of myself and resumed partisan duties. Logic says 51 minus 8 equals 43. That it does. You've been on this island for 43 years? No. He looks into the fire. A wisp of smoke rises from somewhere between the charred logs. I've been on other islands, too. I was on Resurrection until they turned it into a spa in 18. Then I was on E-48, a nameless sound, until the sea washed over it. Then I came back here. That was, he thinks, 22 years ago. Again, you've been hiding here for 43 years? 43 years and 10 months. That's insane. It's not how a human being should live, but I had to, he grimaces. Clearly in pain. I couldn't just forget. I couldn't just forget what I saw. Kim asks, what have you been doing during all this time? Hiding. fishing, waiting. He looks across the water. Always waiting, always. For what? For her to return. Her who? Girl Child Revolution. I come from there, pointing to the mainland. I can assure you that is not what the people are planning. I am not a fool. He blinks his black eyes. I know the material base for an uprising has eroded. The working class has betrayed mankind. The historic opportunity for a revolution has passed. It will not come back anymore, however hard I try, whatever I do. You said you deserted your unit? I was just 16 years old, 15 when I was volunteered. I had a lapse of faith. And of courage, too. A lapse of faith? You could say I misunderstood the heroic role of the proletariat, and thought Mazovian socio-economics were fallible. For a second, I doubted the irreducible laws of historic materialism. A second is all it took. For what? For reaction to take hold. What's reaction? Petty bourgeoisie terror. It's in all men. It wasn't reaction. You were just afraid. It's the same thing. You haven't seen it. Not really. Not naked. It's impossible not to be afraid. Redrick says, it remains unclear what it is. He makes leaps he doesn't expect you to follow. And this was when? The lieutenant instinctively looks to his notebook, but does not take it out. May the 13th, 08, 44 years ago. Looks north. The horizon was black with coalition airships. Their petroleum rose to the sky, and it looked like it formed the clouds. Storm clouds. When they started shelling, it was dark magic. Dark magic. The combined might of international capital, all at once, all the greed and terror in the world, tore into Revachol. It lifted streets from the ground and turned houses into ghosts. We were in the flak tower, he gestures toward it, huddled on the floor. The artillery was 80 kilometers away in Ozon, but I knew the commune would fall. We'd all be turned into ash. So I said I was going to the map room. He looks east. Authority says, a terrible shame. Still within him, the lobes of his ears are red with it, the shame and smallness of what he became. You didn't go to the map room. No. I climbed the chain link across the water and hid inland, in the bunkers there, like the weakest of the weak, a mouse. Frightened of the ordnance all night and the sound of the rotors in the morning, worrying. Th-th-th-th-th-th-th. He looked at the sky. What was that? Airships. I climbed out. He closes his eyes. Into hell. The landing was complete. The chain was submerged. I had to swim back. The fortress was half submerged, too. Shattered. They'd all drowned in the lower levels, or got torn to shreds above. The anti-aircraft gun had malfunctioned. So had I. I left them without ideological direction. He opens his eyes and stares right through you. It was real. I'd seen it. I'd seen it in reality. Seen what? The mask of humanity fall from capital. It has to take it off to kill everyone. Everything you love. All the hope and tenderness in the world. It has to take it off for just 1 second to do the deed. And then you see it, as it strangles and beats your friends to death. The sweetest, most courageous people in the world. He's silent for a second. You see the fear and power in its eyes. Then you know. What? That the bourgeois are not human. Say nothing. Let him finish. I had to fight it. I had to never stop. The old man falls silent. His black eyes keep piercing your skin as he looks to some great distance behind you, shaking his head slowly, retreating from it. I have a lot of questions. What is this place? This island? It's not an island, Droit. I don't know that word. He looks around. It's a defensive fortification of the commune of Revachol, and I am its last surviving defender. What was it used for? The congenitally deformed King Felipe II built it to restrict access to the Bay of Revachol. We captured it in 02 retrofitted the fort with an anti-aircraft gun to defend against an airborne landing against the whole world. You mean the landing? The retaking of Revachol? Coalition military called it Operation Deathblow. He winces. I later found out on the radio they called it Deathblow. You're one of them. Tell me, who speaks like that? We had 50 million people on Kalu alone. First, I'm not one of them. Sure you are. You're RCM. Answer me. Who calls an operation against 50 million people death blow? Murderers. I know what you mean. You don't know. You haven't seen it. He shakes his head slowly. Iblis. Iblis? The black-eyed angel, he nods. Have you survived all this time? Have you concealed yourself all this time? How have you survived all this time? How does anyone survive? He looks at his worn running shoes. I steal. What do you steal? Supplies, vegetables. He winces. I collect rainwater. It's the life of a dog, not a human being. He coughs once more, then puts his hand on his belly. How is your health, Mr. Dross? Kim asks. I've been throwing up blood since winter. Red, like beetroot. Been passing it in stool, too. Visual Calculus says he does seem frail, gaunt for his age, more like 75 than 65. Trouble putting on weight could mean cancer. Kim says the RCM could provide medical services. You need to be looked over. He'd probably rather die than have the RCM help him. I need to die. A droll smile stretches across his mouth. You don't have medical facilities. You have guns. That's all they give you. Toy guns. This is a serious situation. You need to be looked over, and we can do it. There's nothing to look over. The triage is in, and it's black. Administer morphine. Moribund. I don't know about morphine, but we have Dramamine and other opioid-based painkillers. You must be in pain. A light goes on in his eyes. He smacks his dry lips. I have been running out of that stuff. How have you coped, mentally? I haven't. I have holes in my brain. Years missing. Others fill with pain only. A decade of... His eyes roll into his skull and back. I don't even know what. Inferno? I also have holes in my brain. No wonder. All your minds are rotting from the radio waves. He nods towards Martinez. I watch the traitors of this city turn the lights back on, more and more each year. Ruins, glittering in the dark like a merry-go-round. It's disgusting. He looks down at his shoes, his face parched from the sun and the wind. There's a wince of pain in there somewhere. Empathy says, are they not heartbroken? How could they have moved on? How have you concealed yourself all these years? It was hard in the tens, he shakes his head. I didn't have partisan training. They were searching for stragglers. Those bloodhounds. He closes his eyes. Floodlights on the water at night. Kim says there were posters, campaigns. We communards still hoped, and they needed to snuff that hope out. The East capitulated. Martinez and Cole City were turned to dust. He looks south. But Jamrock, Farberg, even Koran, and Boogie Street, of course. Those Kips had Mazav coursing through their veins. And others, too. Some cordons of Revachol was still fighting. There were cells. I tried to contact them. He shakes his head. Soon they all went silent. The frequencies, dead. How did you get between here and the mainland? Well, there's a thing over there. The dinghy, right. That's what I was trying to remember, the word. At night, I used a dinghy. He nods toward the deflated tire in the reeds. I only went after dark then. When I got to the city, I stayed underground. Patrols. You lot. The commons, too. They'd started snitching. Kim's asks, in the city you move underground? From bunker to bunker, he nods. Not anymore. No one cares now. I don't even have to hide. They think I'm another antisocial vagrant. I could walk straight into that town if I wanted. I just... He falls silent, his gaze fixed on the shacks huddled together across the water. Why don't you just walk there? I don't want to. They're all traitors. pigs, rabbits, and dogs. Men without ideals are only animals. Empathy says he does not want to see life moving on. People forgetting, drinking, laughing. I can see that. There's a small bunker under the Feld building. Have you stayed there? The propaganda bunker? I used to, but not anymore. Propaganda bunker? Kim asked. They stored leaflets there, broadcasting equipment too. Made broadcasts, I think. Propaganda officers. I buried them with their leaflets. They killed themselves. Two young boys. Killed themselves? A lot of our boys did. I spent some winters there. Never liked it. Kept thinking of them. He stares at the ruins of the Feld building. No need to go underground anymore. It's better in the ruins on the ground. The weapons cache under St. Ghislaine, 22B, in the basement. Have you been there? He looks at you, then pulls the raincoat tighter around his neck. So you finally found it. There must be a small squadron's worth of arms in there. Bell McGrave's, right? Yeah, right under the bookstore. They were. Useless now. Rusted away. So you've been there, Kim asks. Sleeping. Some nights. Ammo scrounging on others. Those McGraves were crap, even before they corroded. Some had bullets in the chamber, however. Visual calculus says you feel the dots connecting. Little dots on the map he's walked across. Tell me another thing. The old man looks across the water, at the city, the ruins, the motorways rising above it. You said this is your termless surrender. You're with the RCM, he waves in your general direction. The coalition-appointed mob that enforces bourgeois morals in Revachol. We're not coalition-appointed. We just try to help people. He stares at you coldly. You're the RCM. You represent the Moralist International. The enemies of humanity who took this city. I represent their adversary, Le Parti Communiste d'Insulinde. Take me to them as a prisoner of war. I have relinquished my weapon. I can no longer serve. No superiors can relieve me of my duty. You bulldozed them all to a mass grave for trying to free humanity. His hand shakes and he breaks into a coughing fit. Perception says a spray of blood from his mouth on the black charcoal in the fire pit. Rhetoric says, Rene, the royalist on the coast, said, the communards signed the Revacholian instrument of surrender. Liberal reactionaries signed that instrument. Traitors, who should have been burned alive. I answer to the Communist Party. Kim asks, is that part of why you've been here all this time? Because the party didn't surrender? He just wipes the blood from his chin. Been here all this time? Well, that's insane. You're insane. He stares at the fire pit. Radio shows, speed racing, sporting goods. None of it is real. So you're a communist soldier? From the communist army? No, I am not a soldier. I am an ideological officer. I belong to the party, not the army. But you said you were trained and assigned to the Defense Corps. Trained, he nods, in historical materialism, then assigned as a political commissar by the party. These things used to mean something. What does a political commissar do? The old man does not answer. He tilts his silver head and looks at the reeds. You see a small tremor pass through his legs. The lieutenant speaks softly. His job is to assure the army answers to civilian control and follows the ideology of the commune. Scientific communism. The tracksuit-clad old man is suddenly reanimated. A commissionaire politique is a night philosopher of the revolution, a future human. That means you're a trained communist, right? He nods slowly. Then another tremor. Say nothing. He looks away to the sea and lets out a cough. I have another, more serious question for you. There is nothing serious in this world. He looks at the gun lying on the ground. It's a farce. Assess his body language. Okay. What have you been using this gun for? I've used it for killing people. killing people, Kim says. It's a gun. It's what they're for. You want a moralist euphemism defending your family and your property? I haven't done that. I've used it to kill people. Interesting, the lieutenant nods. During or after the war? There is no after the war. He shakes his head and smiles, his teeth rotten black. Class war is never over. Logic says, so he's continued killing after hostilities ended. Okay, okay. Rhetoric says, go in straight, no euphemisms. He doesn't like those. And eye coordination says, no, be careful now. Slow and steady does it. Make him repeat it first. Suggestion says, don't mess this up. Remember, he wants to tell you. Get personal. Take it slow, so don't go right to this. I know you wanted to tell me if you killed anyone in... Wait, so which one do I say then? Nothing comes to you. Silence. His black eyes look at you. Well, thanks. Oh, I know you want to tell me... So you're saying you killed people after active fighting stopped? What did I just say? He keeps shaking his head, erratically, suddenly. He brushes something out of his eye. Rhetoric says, what did I just tell you? Don't drop the ball now. Going straight, no euphemisms. Well, that's not a euphemism. Did you use that gun to shoot and kill a colonel of the security contractor Krennel? The who now? He leans in and cups his ear. He heard you, Drama says. He just wants to hear you say it again. This is dramatic flair on his part. Right choice. We're in. Do it, sire. I should just say it again? The fascist death squad... The corpse in ceramic armor, hanging behind the whirling in rags. Did you shoot him? Oh, yes. That one. He looks up to the sky and clacks his tongue. Ugly piece of work, that boy. Did you kill him? The lieutenant takes a sudden step toward him. Cast gain for extract a confession. I am a son of a welder and an officer of the commune of Revachol. He spits a big one at the lieutenant's feet. I do not collaborate with murderers and pederasts of the liberal regime. You need at least 3 examples of proof to show that you have him anyway. There is little point in his resistance. Logic says, exhaust him with proof. Pile it all on him. Get a confession. Perception says, the scent of blood in the air, but what else? There's something you can't remember. Radio calculus says, something about the tracks? Suddenly all those tracks are so confusing. Go with something else first. We've done the ballistics, pointing to the tower. The shot came from this island. I saw you poking around there, looking for evidence. You're damn diligent when it comes to dead fascists. A jitter passes through him. Did you like the view? Kim says, you had direct visibility. There are embrasures in the concrete, specifically meant for a top faller to use, and you had a long-range rifle in your possession. Are those the 3 things? Direct visibility, embrasures, long-range rifle. We might need more things. The lieutenant softens his voice. You've been here a long time, Mr. Dross. Too long. You clearly need medical aid. I'm ready to die, the man interrupts him, then coughs. I've done my part. Rhetoric says he's practically admitting to it. Dead fascists for fascist. Done his part. It's the best uninterrupted line of sight into that window in all Martinez. Because it's a sniper's nest. You stupid... Beep. Radio Gauche is right. You have worms in your brain. Another sudden twitch. Then one more in his right eye. Okay, what am I forgetting? Hit yourself on the back of the head. Logic says, wait, here it comes. The goddamn Maybells, the dried Maybells on Classier's roof. Oh, yes. And my head hurts now. There were Maybells in the grass when you got here. And Maybells on Classier's balcony. slap myself in the back of the head again. Okay. Reaction speed says, wait, don't forget the footprints. The diagonal prints in the dust in the secret space behind Class A's bedroom. Now they're going to come out. Of course. Thank you, Head. Thank you. You got it. Remember, the boot prints were like no modern soul. Endurance says, maybe don't beat yourself anymore, though? You're not immortal. Nothing else comes up. You see the lieutenant watch you try to stimulate thought process by hitting yourself. Pain Threshold says, I'm sorry, this didn't do anything. You are usually hurting yourself does. Officer, a word? He gestures to talk to you on the side. Excuse us for a moment, Mr. Dross. Alright. Let's talk over here. The lieutenant whispers, then gives the suspect a short glance. Do you think he did it? He nods. From nothing to this, in a day. A crooked little smile. This is good, Lieutenant Euphrator. We just need a confession first, and then maybe a solid motive later. How do you think the questioning is going? Good, he nods. We're doing very good. He wants to confess. I can see that. We just need to pile it on a little more. The more we have on him, the closer he is. Well, that healed my morale. Volition says, you hear that? He thinks you're this close. I'm trying to get him to confess. Yes, good going. That should be our first priority. What am I missing? What haven't I done? Well, I can think of one thing. The gun. He smiles very politely. We should pick it up and discuss it in front of him. Make a show of it. Drama says, yes, sire. Make a production of this examination. I'm slapping myself to get ideas. I can see that, yes. I'm not judging. Okay, let's do this. Remember, the lieutenant whispers, he wants to tell us, but he doesn't want to help us. It needs to look like we already have everything. Empathy says, there is palpable excitement in his tone. He likes him for this, a lot, but there's something more, too. Logic says, he thinks the deserter has more than just his case in him. 44 years here. You think he has more than this case? Oh yes, he nods. And he hasn't spoken to anybody in a long time. If we get him open, who knows what will pour out. Pat him on the back. Just saving here. Restarting the recording, just in case. Okay, so we can't just pick up the gun. We have to talk to him to get it.
Minions of Capital, what do you want?
Pick up the gun lying in the sand. His gaze follows your emotions. The rifle feels surprisingly light in your hand, frame stocked and patched in places with tape and wire.